is because the Delhi High Court had some very harsh words for the excise department. It pulled up the tax man over the arrest of an executive of Make My Trip. The court, while disapproving the manner in which the officers arrested the Make My Trip official, said such conduct cannot be accepted. It has demanded, in fact, personal petitions from all of the tax officers that were in favor of the arrest, and went on to say that the job of the tax man cannot be to arrest. They are not police officers. So we're putting the spotlight on that. It is also budget week. So when we were going through the fine print of the budget document, we discovered that India is going to become the first country to introduce what is popularly known as the Google tax. That means it wants to tax online and digital advertising. Without any further ado, let's go across to Dinesh Kanabar, the CEO of Dhruva Advisors. Thanks, Mr. Kanabar, for joining us here on The Big Picture. I'm going to first just quickly begin with service tax, because that's the reason we started looking into the entire issue and what we saw in the Delhi High Court today with respect to Make My Trip. Now, what we understand and what Arun Jaitley has made clear in Budget 2016 is that there can be no arrest in case the alleged evasion is not up to 2 crore rupees. Let's not forget that the arrest provision was only provided in 2013 in that budget. My first question to you is this going to provide relief for service taxpayers, or you think the 2 crore rupee is far too small?
It's really not about 2 crores of rupees, Dayantara. There were 4 situations provided last year, subject to which an arrest could be taking place, and those 4 circumstances included collecting service tax and not paying it to the government, or if there was any evasion of taxes or a wrong credit was claimed, etc. So as to whether a person has evaded tax, as to whether credit has been rightly claimed, wrongly claimed, are matters of interpretation, and there ought not to be an arrest of a person and his personal liberty being put to stake for a matter which is interpretive in nature. And what has happened in this budget is actually a very, very welcome step forward, where instead of those 4 conditions, there is now only 1 condition under which arrest can happen, and that is where service tax has been collected and not paid, which is very much understandable. You cannot collect service tax from your constituents and then deny the payment of those taxes to the government treasury. So it is this reduction of these 4 conditions, some of which are very subjective, to just 1 condition, which is very objective, which is very, very welcome. The increase in the monetary limit from 1 crore to 2 crores may or may not benefit people. That's not really important. The important thing is doing away with subjectivity.
So when you do away with that subjectivity, what I want to ask you is that could that reduce, you know, what we call, harassment by the tax department, or, you know, curb the powers of what is being called an aggressive tax department?
So until now, and of course we have to wait till June when the provisions get enacted, a service tax official could walk in, and if he felt that you are either claiming a wrong credit or you are evading service tax, which could, as I said, be a matter of interpretation, you could be a subject matter of arrest, and that could lead to a needless harassment. Now, unless a situation exists where taxes have been collected but have not been paid over, there can't be an arrest, and therefore, yes, I agree with you that the so-called harassment would now no longer exist.
Okay, so you're saying this is the much needed relief. I like to point out, we don't mean that government is providing relief to service tax evaders. That's just a mistake on our part, the topic that was there. You know, Mr. Kanabar, what I also want to ask you is that a lot of this budget has been hijacked by this entire controversy with the EPF. Like you were pointing out, there is some relief that has come in on the service tax payment front, you know, the kind of harassment that you saw, just the kind of burden that payers had to go through. It's also been there for the small taxpayers. I'm talking about the professionals with incomes to 50 lakh rupees, or small businesses, when you talk about presumptive tax. How transformational is that?
So a number of changes out there. First is that the people, small businesses, so there are 2 separate categories of taxpayers, small businesses and small professionals. Small professionals is a new provision altogether, where if you are a professional and your income is up to 50 lakhs of rupees, your receipts are up to 50 lakhs of rupees, then you could be governed by a presumptive taxation where you don't need to maintain books of accounts, you don't need to produce any vouchers, and 50% of your receipts would be regarded as your taxable income. You take that, pay the presumptive tax and move on. Similarly, in the case of small businesses, the limits have been considerably enhanced. They are subjected to tax at the rate of 8% of their gross receipts. There the threshold limit has been expanded, and the limit at which tax audit is required to be carried out has been expanded.
So how significant is this when we also talk about ease of doing business? Because once the scrutiny is out, of course, you know, the citizens, the taxpayers have to, or the tax assessees have to do their bit. And when they do the self-attestation, it's presumed on the fact that they're going to be honest. But Mr. Kanabar, is this going to go a long way in the ease of doing business?
So look at three or four initiatives which have been taken simultaneously. One is in the case of Startup India, where if you are a new enterprise, your profits for 3 out of 5 years are exempt. And there could be, of course, situations where such profits may not come about. Also, you are subjected to a lower tax of 25% instead of 30%. So the commitment made by the finance minister that we are going to lower the rate of tax from 30 to 25%, of course, gross up for surcharges, etc., has actually been put into place for the first time for startup companies. So, however, that they cannot avail of any deductions or exemptions other than in respect of additional employment which they have created. A very, very welcome provision. One sore thumb out there is that they are subjected to MAT, which I think should not be applicable to them at all. I'm sure there will be representations on the subject and there will be a relook on the subject. Then look at small professionals, small businesses. For all of them, really, there has been enough and more. But I must also point out to you, and that's not a question which you have put to me, that this has been one budget where if you go through the fine print, which you normally dread because there are hidden issues out there, there is enough and more fine print here, which is very, very positive, which has not even found place in the finance minister's speech. And I could give you at least half a dozen examples of situations where controversy has been going on year, matters are pending before courts, and all of them have been clarified and clarified in favor of the taxpayers in this budget.
Okay, so you're saying a lot of measures have come in for the small taxpayers as well as the companies that was also talked about by Arun Jaitley in his budget speech. We'll get to all of those another day, Mr. Kanabar. You know, we're running out of time. Now I want to talk to you about India actually taking the lead in taxing digital advertising, online advertising, which in a layman term we refer to as a Google tax. What is all of this about?
So it's a very interesting provision. Generally, there has been an issue that if you are a non-resident in a particular country, you can be taxed in that country on your business profits only and only if you have a permanent establishment in that country. Permanent establishment, simply put, requires a physical presence of some sort. In this digital world, a question has come up that you could actually carry on business in a country using electronic means, whereby you don't really have to have a physical presence at all. And this was a subject matter which came up before the OECD when they came up with the BEPS proposition and BEPS exam. The committee which was set up to look at BEPS came up with a series of action points. And the first of the action points, not surprisingly, was looking at taxation of digital transactions. And there was a general acceptance there that the concept of permanent establishment needs a relook. However, how would it be relooked was not something which was done in action item one at all. What was considered, however, is that there could be three potential ways in which digital online advertisement transactions could be taxed. And having examined all those three bases, the OECD said this is not the right time to do it. If, however, a country chooses to tax such transactions, it has to do so mindful of its treaty obligations. And India has become one of the first countries in the world to levy what we call as an equalization tax. Very simply put, what it means is that if today an Indian company was to advertise electronically or for a digital advertisement, then a 6% withholding tax is required to be made. One of the very peculiar things of this whole proposition is that this is not a levy under the Income Tax Act. Rather, it is a levy under the Finance Bill, or what will now become a Finance Act. So it will be Chapter 8 of the Finance Act 2016. And what that does is that since it is not a tax on income, it is a tax on payment made for advertisements, the recipient will not get a credit for the taxes withheld in the home country, because under tax treaties you can get credit only for taxes which are covered by the Income Tax Act, and this is not a tax covered by the Income Tax Act.
And so how is this, Mr. Kanabar, sorry to interrupt you there, how is this going to pan out, and what is it going to be its impact on, let's say, Startup India, on Digital India?
I don't think this really has an impact merely on Startup or Digital India. This is an impact on everybody who is doing any online advertising, be it a startup, be it an established entity, be it a marketing company, everybody. So the FMCGs would do advertisement, you do advertisement on a YouTube, you do advertisement wherever. All such advertisements are now going to be hit by the equalization levy. And just to answer your question as to what does this mean, is that the recipients are not going to accept the withholding and are going to ask for payments net of tax, because they cannot get a credit for that in the home country, and therefore advertisement will become so much more expensive, because now that 6% will be borne on a grossed up basis by the advertiser. So the advertiser now has two levies to suffer. One is a reverse service tax at 15%, and the second is equalization levy.
Right, so it's going to skew the level playing field that India has with the rest of the countries, I think is the point that Mr. Kanabar was trying to make. Let's see if the finance minister changes his mind before this bill is enacted. As always, a pleasure to have you on the show, Mr. Kanabar. Thanks very much for joining us.